Hey there, gamers, I am Pruitt, and this is Jim Davis. The stage is set, the pieces are in place. Or are they? It's Miniatures versus Theater of the Mind on WebDM. Let's delve deep into our minds. No, we're gonna use minis.
Oh, so. Yes, all right, yeah.
No. Mm-mm. So, what? Okay, where do you choose between that? Let's unpack these two kind of ways to play.
We've got two sort of poles of a spectrum here.
Yeah.
Right? We've got the full-on miniatures lifestyle, almost, where not just the things that you paint and use on the battle map, but you've got the terrain and maybe even a fog machine. All that really cool stuff, like all the bells and whistles.
The LEDs in your chapels.
Yeah, just like all the bells and whistles of it. And so it ranges everything from that, the big sort of big setups with the big 3D terrain, everything's painted and looks really great, to just some people sitting around and you know, not even a piece of paper that they're scrawling, you know, their relative positions on for the Theater of the Mind. And, you know, if you're a new player or something, you might wonder how they all sort of work. Or if you're a new Dungeon Master, you might feel like, well, there's the precision of miniatures has a kind of comfort to it. How could I switch to Theater of the Mind?
I don't know. For me, I would see kind of as a new player, maybe having just something would take off a little bit of the anxiety of like what's going on. You know, you're trying to learn a new system, but you're also trying to keep the context of the scene in mind. So even just a piece of paper can be good for that. Let's start with minis. Go with some pros and cons for those.
Pros and cons of miniatures. So miniatures, to me, the big draw of them is that they're just cool. I don't know if it's Micro Machines or Lego or just who I am as a person, but for me at least, the appeal of miniatures is that they're this sort of small physical representation of a character or a monster. Mm-hmm. Or something there.
Yeah.
You know, they have a display factor to them when you're not using them.
They are generally portraying some kind of action.
And they're inspirational in that regard, right? Like, there's a lot of times when I've, in this one in particular, I don't know if you guys can see, but he's a dwarf, you know, sort of like maybe half plate on or three quarters plate shield, battle axe. This is one of my favorite ones because it's I find like, all right, that's my dwarf, right? When I think of the dwarven fighter that I'm playing, looks like this miniature.
Yeah.
You know, when I think of you know, an elven archer or something, I've got a wide array for them, and it's a physical manifestation. For those of us who are tactile people who like to you know, sort of see how everything's arranged and see the you know, the detail of it, it can be very inspirational. It can sort of spur characters and NPCs and you know, just staring at a miniature for a while and thinking like, oh, look at this monster, like how would this thing move, how would this thing react to the environment it was around. It just it could just be fun to use as inspiration.
Especially if you've gone through the whole process of painting it, and maybe while you were painting it, you maybe messed up a part on its side. Well, guess what? Then when you get ready to use it, you look at it like, well, that imperfection, that could be a wound. Well, what gave it that wound?
What gave it that wound?
And now you're giving your monster lore based off of that direct inspiration.
Sure, and this ties into the whole fact that miniatures are a potential hobby in and of themselves. My painting is sufficient for my needs, but those who really want to get into it, treat this as a separate hobby itself that they can then use for their role-playing games. You know, there's all manner of paints and supplies and that kind of thing, and a lot of satisfaction that comes from learning the different techniques of painting and getting a miniature that you really like and it looks really good. It can be a lot of fun. And and so what types of miniatures are we talking about here? We could talk about, like, these are the pewter, although I don't think I have any more lead miniatures. They do usually actually have lead miniatures. You have to wash your hands afterwards.
Let's just put the gloves on.
I had them as a child as well, so yeah, but it
explains a lot.
I don't know. Yeah, I didn't need any of them, I don't think. Anyway,
don't remember.
Pewter is what these are made of. Now you see more in resin, plastic, whether they are the kind of like collectible plastic miniatures that are sort of pre-painted, and the detail on them is great. Some people repaint these, though, and they look really cool. And then there's also flat minis, right? Whether we're talking like clear plastic with an image on them that you can have, or paper minis that you just sort of
like sit in a stand. But
sometimes it's in a stand, sure.
But I really like those because, to me, that's kind of a very easy way to use minis. And you just find them, print them off, cut them out, and put them in their little stand, and you know, you don't have to worry about them breaking. The thing is with minis, honestly, I'm scared. because I do like them, and I had so much fun painting that one finally when I had a few tricks.
Yeah,
I
want you to.
It kind of, it's one of those things where it's like you might try it a few times and you're like, ugh, and it sucks, and you're like, oh, I can't do this. That's just not my thing. But it's like, no. Just keep going. Because I really now, since then, I think about minis all the time. And I still haven't allowed myself to indulge yet, because I know that once I do, I'm going to slip into that ravine. And I'm not sure I'll be able to climb out until I get a Hero Forge tower built to get me out of that ravine.
Yeah, sure. And then, of course, a cousin to the miniatures are the different terrain options, whether that's the full-on 3D resin, like Dwarven Forge or some other places, or it's dungeon tiles, whether they're made by D&D or like the flip mats and things that Pathfinder or Paizo makes for Pathfinder and other RPGs. There's a lot of different configurations of these. I have a ton of the dungeon tiles from D&D that was kind of like the only thing I bought during 4th edition was dungeon tiles and miniatures.
Yeah.
But I tried to pick them up when I could, and lo and behold, I now have a rather large collection of miniatures that has almost one of almost everything that I might need, and as well as multiples, you know, miscellaneous town guard who's like a parallel to the ground.
Yeah.
cons?
For minis? That cheddar, baby.
Yeah.
I mean, if you're talking going full tilt into it, that's going to be expensive as hell just for an accessory to the game you want to play.
It's one of those things where, you know, maybe you can double up. You're playing like a war game or a tabletop battle game and can also use the miniatures for that. You know, maybe it's like Warhammer, The Lord of the Rings, or Kings of War, or forget War Machine, whatever. I'm not a war gamer, so those are just the ones I remember seeing at the store.
Yeah.
but you maybe double up like that and get some double use out of them. Maybe the group just kind of pitches in and your group has a collection of miniatures that sort of stays wherever you guys play the game, and it's just sort of anyone can use the miniatures.
Yeah, that's one way to maybe mitigate that cost
if you have
a solid group that meets regularly and you want to start doing that, pitching in for those tiles and terrains and
but if you're talking about doing this as a hobby, it can get very expensive, and so take your time. The upside of this is that there now are much cheaper miniatures available. If you do like the Reaper Bones line, a lot of times you can get those for the same sculpts, the same models that would be in a pewter miniature, but they're much cheaper as the resin or plastic. And then there's the new ones from, I think, WizKids.
Oh, yeah.
They're both a Pathfinder and a D&D line. So a lot of like the iconic type of monsters, and particularly characters. Like if you need like an Air Ganassi monk, you've got two of them. And so those are fun to look through and are relatively affordable compared to some of the other stuff that's out there. But it's not just expensive in money. It's expensive in time. It takes time to learn how to paint, how to master the techniques, get it to where you want. It can be frustrating, or you want it to look perfect right away.
Mm-hmm.
It's like everything else. Practice makes perfect. Storage and upkeep are a big one.
Yeah.
That's the biggest hurdle for me, and the thing that limits my collection to what it is. I have miniatures that I've painted and lovingly cared for, lovingly painted, and then threw in a box with other metal miniatures, unsealed, right? I didn't seal them. Unprotected from the ravages of other metal miniatures bumping up against them and breaking in the box, and
collection of hands and weapons at the bottom.
And most of mine are in Ziploc bags that have like a little post-it note on them as to what's in the actual thing. It helps me sift through them, but you know, when I'm preparing for a game, I've got to spend a lot of time sifting through the minis box and sort of like looking for things. I know some people use like tackle boxes, stuff like that, or cheaper storage options, but it's an expensive hobby if you're really going to get into it and you want to take care of these miniatures that you're spending a lot of time on. The last two, to me, cons for miniatures deal with the game itself and the players who play that game. Using miniatures takes up time. And if pacing, if a fast-paced combat, if that kind of thing is important to you, then having a lot of miniatures, and particularly if you've got like a gridded battle mat or terrain or something, then that's going to just, number one, take time to set up, take time to navigate around. But also, it affects player thinking.
Yeah.
And that thinking inside the grid is a thing that happens to players who play a lot with battle mats and grids and things like that, where they start to only think in terms of the visual aids that they have to play the game, and not the fact that the game starts up here and these are just
representations.
That the miniatures are not the game itself. It's just a visual aid for it.
Yeah.
And so there are some DMs who find that if they move away from the grid, their players sort of open up, get a bit more creative, get a bit more engaged in the game, and stop maybe treating it like a board game or not really getting into it. That can kind of help.
Let's take it internal now.
Oh.
Move over to the place where we tell the bard's tale in the theater. Of the mind.
Theater of the mind refers to just using your imagination. Mm-hmm. And it's big budget. It has no limits. The pros of theater of the mind are that if you want to battle with thousands of ravaging demons.
Oh my God.
And you know, warriors atop glistening dragons as they fly through the sky, dealing out righteous justice. Mm-hmm. All of that.
Yeah.
Right up here. And that can be difficult, right? You don't have the miniatures that you want to use for it, or you don't have adequate representation. And having that freedom to just like go where your imagination takes you and not have to worry about how you're going to portray it on a battle mat or a play field, it can be really helpful. You don't need a big table. You don't need to store the stuff anywhere. You just can sit down and start playing without having to worry about a setup or anything.
That moment whenever it's like you hit find an enemy and it's like, okay, roll initiative. A lot of times when you're using minis, you then stop, okay, and everybody, like, we got to clear the table and put the mat out and you make everybody's mini, and then like 5-6 minutes later you start it. Now some people can use that for like prepping for combat,
right
it shouldn't really be prepping for combat that is sprung upon them.
Yeah,
theater of the mind though. Boom. Okay, roll initiative. Roll initiative as something boom. Pops out. Oh shit, really what quick. What really what quick.
Part of the style you'll develop for yourself, in that, you know, if you are someone that likes really spontaneous combats, things like that, you might find that having a lot of game aids is a barrier to that spontaneity, even if you're doing a lot to prep for them. In the beginning, theater of the mind is a way to kind of cut out all of that. And then obviously, again, sort of working off Pruitt's point, that theater of the mind is a way to break free of that thinking in the grid and thinking about combat purely in terms of how many squares can I move, what's the area of something, like, and really sort of imagining your character as in a much more dynamic environment and presenting what you want to do as like, all right, I'd like to do this thing. Am I close enough to hit, or this guy's already melee with me, I'm going to fight him and then leap over the table and do this thing. It gives some freedom for players, particularly those who've only played one way, to try playing a different way. Cons for Theater of the Mind? I would say the big one is it can be confusing. That,
yes.
The lack of precision can lead to a lot of, wait, what's going on? Who's here? You know.
Yeah, yeah.
Who can I attack?
Yeah, pretty much every player needs to be focused on the combat all throughout, because you might look at your phone and miss a description while it was another player's turn.
Right.
And it was important because it's like, oh, I was going to target the guy with a spell. Where is he now?
Right.
Because you weren't paying attention. On a, you know, on a mat, you can see clearly where they are, right?
Right. And so that sort of fuzziness, that lack of clarity, lack of precision, it might frustrate some players. It might frustrate the dungeon master. There might be a lot of back and forth as everybody tries to figure out who and what is available. There are techniques that the dungeon master can use to mitigate some of that. You know, you're starting from a position of everybody in their own heads imagining something. They're not all imagining the same thing. Yeah. It's up to the DM to get them to all imagine the same thing together.
Yeah, at least clear, close to the same thing. One thing that I do is at the start of each round, I try to reframe.
Yes, yeah.
You know, okay, yeah. End of the round. Now, they moved over here and you attacked. They did that. You cast the spell.
Yeah.
Back to the top of initiative with Elry, who has these people on him. Go.
Yeah. Like, reframing that way, particularly quickly. And you're just like, boom, boom, boom. And doing that when you set up a person's turn, player A has just gone. Player B's about to go. Quick summary. Player A just did this. You have, this is the situation in your immediate vicinity. What do you do? And then, you know, it might be like, well, okay, there's two on me that I'm fighting. Well, can I also, you know, is there anyone else nearby that I need to worry about? You sort of ask questions in the same way that miniatures play, dealing with the miniatures, attending to them, getting them where you want them, and then sort of counting everything out, that sort of thing can slow down play. This process of clarifying what's going on, who can act, and who's, you know, nearby or whatever, can also slow down theater of the mind play.
Yeah, yeah, okay. Well, so what are some alternatives? You know, some hybrids, something to kind of patch between.
The hybrids are more like everything from a big piece of paper with that you just have scratches on, you know, X's and O's. Or the character's name or something like that. You rather go like a craft store or a department store or something and just get like a big pad of newsprint or something like that.
Or like a whiteboard.
Or a whiteboard is another one.
Or a blackboard, you know, just for dry erase, and you can just, you know, sketch it out, erase.
And these can be prepared ahead of time. You can sort of draw the map on them in great detail and sort of reveal them as needed, or you can write all over them and it doesn't matter if you're getting them stained or something, whether you use the right markers and the like. A lot of things like whiteboards and battle mats require specific writing implements that you use on them. And if you use a different one, you might stain it permanently or damage it in some way. It doesn't matter what happens to it. Somebody spills something on it, who cares? Like, usually more portable. If you're going to a convention or something, you draw one, fold up the piece of paper and stick it in the back of a book, and that's it. And because you can draw all over it, write NPC names on it, keep track of the rounds, keep track of conditions that are affecting players. I really like having, in my games, some kind of thing that everyone can write on in the open. Most of the time we use a battle mat, but a big piece of paper or scratch paper or something can do that. You can also use all manner of things as tokens to represent miniatures.
Oh,
right?
God. We've used everything from dice. To coins. Mm-hmm. Monopoly pieces.
Monopoly pieces, other board game pieces, other just weird miniature stuff you've got around.
Pencil erasers?
Pencil erasers, certainly. The little pawns that look like VTT tokens. Uh-huh.
We've used Lego Men before.
Lego Men for...
why not?
Right. empty Kleenex boxes become forts, and paper towel rolls become wizard's towers.
Yeah.
Just little things you have around the house. Little curios and knickknacks and tchotchkes and baubles and the like that you just sort of might have. Any of those can be a monster, a structure, an arcane monument, mm-hmm. an objective for the party to fight over. And you might get a situation where you've got a play area that's got some people with their painted minis, someone else with just a thing, they don't care. And you've got all these sort of household objects, a stapler, a salt shaker, you've got some pipe cleaner that's been bent into the shape of a spell template. How are you also using your imagination to turn that beautiful mess into something that's really fun and interesting to play and like really helps you get that game going? We're talking a bit about like things to ride on and whatever. If you do use a battle mat, upkeep is a big factor, making sure you have the right tools to use to ride on it, not using like a wet erase when it needs to be a dry erase or vice versa. Mm-hmm. The other thing to sort of look at is that some battle mats have grooves. Yeah. On them to keep miniatures from slipping, and those become very difficult to clean over the years, and that side of the battle mat will get very dirty and dingy, and old stains from past adventures will continue to show up on it. So that's just something to think about. Don't leave the stuff you ride on them overnight. Clean it up after the adventure so that you don't have to worry about it. But otherwise, a battle mat can be really fun. Sometimes mm-hmm. they have a grid, sometimes it's a hex grid. You can use it for a lot of different things. Doesn't have to be just for battles. It can be for writing NPC names, sketching out larger layouts of a village or a city or something like that. Put it in as a stand-in for, big piece of paper or something like that.
Other things that people can use outside of that?
I mean, I know that there are blank dungeon tiles that sort of serve the same function as a battle mat, sort of they've got a pre-printed grid on them or something. Mm-hmm. And then, of course, there's also VTTs, the virtual tabletops that some people use like at their tables and sort of mm-hmm. have some kind of display or a projector or something, and then everyone kind of logs in, and then it's the dungeon master who sort of moves things around. Or maybe they've got such an elaborate setup that everybody's kind of able to be logged into the VTT as well as present in the same room together. That kind of sounds like a fun setup.
Those setups, again, as cost is going to be an issue, but if you can afford it, I want to do the top-down projector on the table where you just move your minis on that. That just, because that just seems so freaking cool.
That does seem really cool. And a lot of the things that that get in the way of using miniatures and the like can be mitigated by those sort of projectors, like thing like dungeon tiles or spell templates or something like that require you to pick up the miniatures, put something underneath them, place them back down where they were. Takes up time, might not mm-hmm. be exactly where it is. You can kind of lay it down on top of them. Those are sort of things that you might consider if you're using miniatures, right? You want to make sure that your maps, the players know what scale that they are. Sometimes dungeon maps in the official products are like one square is 20 feet or something like that. And if you're using an official map there, you want to make sure you've got the scale right and have either added a different grid or changed the, manipulated the image in some way as to create a proper scale. If it's a map that you're drawing yourself, just making sure that it's clear what is and isn't part of the map outside of it. Even if you're not using a grid, you can still use miniatures and just measure them with like a, you know, a ruler or a bit of string that you've marked off. You know, you've got, I've got my 30-foot string, my 60-foot string.
Yeah, you just decide what what distance is is what.
Now, if we're talking about Dungeons and Dragons, in D&D, there's some page references that you might want to look at for using miniatures. And those are page 192 in the PHB, a little bitty you know, box of variant playing on a grid rules. The DMG, page 250, has a lot of rules for you know, miniatures play. And in all of these cases, these are rules that you use if you need them. You know, you don't always need them, but it's like, okay, how do I figure out if something's in cover or not? For a miniature, or whether someone has line of sight on it, or if I don't have a miniature that, that has a base that's actually the size of the miniature that or the creature that it's supposed to represent, what am I supposed to do there? That's what those rules sort of answer. And then in Xanathar's Guide to Everything on page 86, there's some more helpful rules for using like area of effect of spells, things like that. How to calculate that? How to calculate a cone on a grid, on a square grid. I like the ones that use dice for, you know, you just like plunk down dice where the area of effect would be, and then just count up in that, and then you just pick the dice back up and go on. For Theater of the Mind, I'm thinking things like page 249 in the DMG, that chart that lets you know how many creatures are caught in an area of effect. And it's a series of formulas. You take the area of effect of the spell and divide it, usually divide it by one of the numbers on the chart, and that'll tell you how many creatures are impacted by it, and without you needing to roll up a number arbitrarily or something like that. It gives you a bit more firm guidelines for it. The big one, though, for Theater of the Mind play is distance. Yeah. And making sure that everybody is on the same page with distance. I'm kind of thinking like three or four different ways to do it, but you've been a player during some of these, right? Like we've done like the Numenera style of close, near, far.
Right, right. Or yeah, close, short, far.
Yeah, and then where there's the a way of always describing distances and say like this is within 30 feet or it's further than 30 feet away. You know, you're
go ahead and round off to the distances that D&D uses.
Right,
you know? I mean, like to the common ones. You know, oh, they're a move action. Yeah, they're 30 feet away, or they're a double move. So that's 60 feet, which is a lot of like spell ranges and stuff like that. Fit it within the bounds that are already there in the verbiage of the spells and the movement.
Yeah.
And it just makes play a little bit easier.
Yeah.
If you're doing Theater of the Mind, you're like, oh, they're 75 feet away. Okay, so that means I need to do 1, 2 and a half moves.
Yeah.
Like, it, just eliminate that.
Just eliminate that. You know, embrace the fact that there's not a lot of precision.
Yeah.
And I even sort of go one step further. Sometimes I describe things in terms of how many moves it would take the character to get there. You do need to factor in different speed rates and things like that. You know, the monk and barbarian or, you know, someone with a magic spell boosting them is going to have a different move rate, obviously. But making sure that you're very clear. So an example of that would be, all right, fighter, you have the following enemies within melee range.
Yeah.
Now, if we were looking at it on a grid, it might be that one of them's like 5 feet over there, the other one's like 10 feet, but those are negligible distances. It doesn't cost much to move around and do that, and so you would just say like, all right, fighter, you have 5 potential enemies within melee range of you. It looks like some of them are fighting your ally, and 2 more are closing in. They're not quite in melee, but they will be there next round. What do you do? They've given them an option of like, all right, there's these creatures right here that are being fought, some of them fighting an ally. Can I leave that ally to themselves? Or have they got this covered? Or do we need to fight back to back? Is there something I can do about the ones that are coming in?
Yeah.
That kind of thing. And then maybe you describe for the spellcaster or the archer later on, you know, it's like, all right, there's a big scrum of melee right in front of you and everybody's back and forth and shields are bashing against each other and war cries are resounding out, but you can see some skirmishers and the like slinking off to the side. They are within range of your attack. You know, go for it. And that maybe that relies on the Dungeon Master knowing the different kinds of attacks that the players have, or it relies on the players communicating that information to them. But it's also one of those areas where you want to be clear, you know, what are the short and long distances of the ranged weapons that are being used. A lot of times with Theater of the Mind, that sort of stuff gets collapsed down. And those players and the characters that have options that mitigate some of those things, whether it's spell sniper or sharpshooter or something, those choices are somewhat diminished if you sort of collapse everything down into too simplified and too abstract. a setup. Whether it's the zones in Melee, close, far, or using the common ranges for D&D, that D&D uses, or whatever system you're using, really, those are some techniques you can use to kind of make sure that everyone is on the same page in terms of where the distance is, mm-hmm. and that you are framing a person's round and what they are going to do there in terms of the options that they have. If they are wanting to do something different or something else, that's when you kind of go towards, okay, let's kind of talk this out. But you can sort of set things up, say like, all right, these are people in Melee. These are the ones that are closing by. No cover, no nothing between you and them. Or, you know, there's like light cover. It looks like they're moving through the underbrush or something. Keeping your descriptions short, focused on their impact of the game, and asking leading questions for the players so that they know that there are options available for them and that they can choose those, or they can question you further for other options, is a way to help speed up and mitigate some of that lack of precision for Theater of the Mind. To me, the closing thought is to just embrace what you got. If you're fortunate enough to be in a position to have a big setup with a lot of cool stuff, then embrace it and mm-hmm. take pictures and show them to us. Yeah. If you are...
we want to live vicariously through you.
Yes. If you were just starting out and you got a mishmash of stuff and paper minis that you found online and a couple of metal ones that you've had from a long time ago or whatever, just embrace that and don't worry so much about it not being perfect or whatever. Sometimes a piece of terrain is just like literally a cardboard tube glued to a piece of a cereal box and spray painted gray. Mm-hmm. And how is that not like a column or a ruin, you know, the ruins of an ancient civilization? It's nice to have the big shiny stuff, but there is a satisfying gameplay to be had in the more just DIY, whatever's around the house, mm-hmm. a way of doing things.
Yeah, Theater of the Mind, though, communication is key.
Communication is key, yep. Communication is key.
Head on over to Patreon for our weekly podcast and so much more. WebDM is also on Twitch with 3 weekly games, which we upload to WebDM Plays, our second YouTube channel.
I'm a sucker for
almost a decade now. I run board games out of it. I run RPG games out of it. Awesome. I've probably had something like 300 to 400 people play in my world.
That's awesome.
It is so much fun.
I recognize your voice. Do you have a podcast?
I did. It was called The Dungeon Master's Handbook.
I love your podcast. Oh,
well,
my God.
Unfortunately, I didn't have very much feedback.
Uh-huh.
And it got to a point where I'm like, I'm putting all this time into it, I'm getting no feedback. So I let it go. But yeah. I do have a blog, and mm-hmm. I thought about that if I ever have a subject that I want to podcast about, I'll put it on the blog.
Put it on the blog. So you've got the 3 hexes. That's how I found your blog.
Yeah, 3 hexes.
We are WebDM. We're a YouTube D&D and RPG advice channel.
Thank you.
We have recommended your blog to many of our viewers because
I'm so grateful.
We've got a series on just like running hex crawls in Dungeons and Dragons mostly. Like I said, I loved yours. It was like one of those where I'd listen to the DM's handbook and be like, oh my God, I can use this in my game. And I didn't know you were here. It's awesome. These are all like the original.
No, Raul Partha has come back. These are recent casts.
Recent casts, but they're like the original molds, or?
Yes, they are.
Because I love the look of like.
These are true 25 millimeters.
Yeah.
How much of this is the percentage of your total setup? Would you say?
These tables are half of what I brought.
Two or all 3 tables, or just this?
Yeah, all 3.
Sweet.
Yeah.
Sweet.
And this is only half of what you brought?
Yeah.
Awesome.
Kind of just doing my part, trying to get miniatures as part of the con.
Yeah.
You know, I know it's historically been role-playing and board gaming and stuff like that.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, as we get older, we get free time games as deep as we used to.
Yeah, yeah.
Isn't there anymore.
No.
And the skirmish games have really come on strong.
It's like the Kill Team.
Kill Team. I mean, every miniature company has a skirmish level now.
Right.
This is full-blown 40K.
Yeah.
So it's a little light turnout, I hope. But we're doing Kill Team again tomorrow on Saturday. It's a narrative game. So we started telling the story last night.
Uh-huh.
So the events of each game affect everything down the Choose Your Own Adventure.
Okay. Right, right.
Because basically, you have a choice to make. Like, you can take the easy way out and come score this, or you can stretch it a little,
right.
And, you know, this could pay off.
This could be payoff, yeah.
Following. We played kill team last night. So the guys that were captured in the fight, they're trying to bust out today.
Sweet.
In full 40K scale.
Sweet.
So, but the thing is, they're all locked up in different parts of the board. They don't know where they are, so it's going to be random what they find.
Yeah.
So what I've done is I've got, like, there's six cells on every table. So as many, at the end of the game, however many cells they've captured, they're going to roll to see what they get.
Mm.
So some of them are going to be assets. Like, they found Otis, the town drunk.
Yeah.
But he's actually, you know, the sewer, you know, the rat catcher in the sewer. Right. He's got keys to the
you can
sewer.
Get anywhere. Yeah.
So, you know, your next game, you get a free deep strike.
It reminds me a bit of, like, Necromunda.
Yeah.
In some ways, where you, like, build your gang up over time.
That and Blood Bowl are my favorite games because you could have those campaigns.
Mm-hmm.
And your guys gain skills, gain right. injuries, you know, uh-huh. lost an arm, you know, things like that. And
yeah.
So, you know, I really, really dug those. And it was always random. You know, you had to roll to see what you got.
See what happened. Yep.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
Uh-huh.
So, yeah, no, Necromunda's huge. Yeah. And I'm a big fan of the elevations. That's why the Mechanicus table down there has lots of...
Like, just levels and things.
Lots of levels. So you can jump off stuff and climb up. Over.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. Like I was talking, we were talking a minute ago about whenever I was gaming on for Warhammer 40K, it was just like cardboard tubes and coffee cans.
And it was lots of VCR.
Yep.
You know, fortifications, like, yep. you know, VCR tape stacked up, mm-hmm. tubes. And,